I'm delighted to bring up a dear friend of both mine and the museum's, Dr. Joel Spencer, who will introduce tonight's talk.
Thank you, Cindy. It's always really a pleasure to come back to MoMath, and it's a particular pleasure to be at the Math Encounters. So mathematicians love games, Go, chess, bridge, but all kinds of games. My personal favorites are Sorry, always loved Sorry, and my current favorite is Ticket to Ride, which is a wonderful game. And mathematicians love to analyze games, like tic-tac-toe and n-dimensions, whatever. And some highly creative mathematicians like to create games. And Jim is a highly creative, highly inventive mathematician. And his world always has new, interesting ideas, always with an intriguing geometry involved with it. His approaches to mathematics are always fascinating. Jim's talents were recognized early. He was magna cum laude in math as an undergraduate at Harvard. And after some seasoning at that other Cambridge across the pond, he received his PhD in ergodic theory from Berkeley. He's visited Harvard, Olin, Brandeis, Maryland, consulted at Microsoft, AT&T. He's been on the faculty of University of Washington and is currently professor at University of Massachusetts at Lowell. And my own personal connection with Jim is with his chip firing game, where there are piles of chips on, let's say, the lattice points in the plane, but it could be much more general than that. And then Jim has a way of moving them around in some strictly deterministic fashion that he's came up with. My contribution is I call it the prop machine, to name it for him, and I think it's caught on. But it appears as though all the chips are moving randomly. And Jim's ideas have started an entire area of what's called quasi-random walks, walks that are totally deterministic, and yet they behave as though they're random walks. So how do mathematicians prove theorems? Well, Bertrand Russell described the finished product in his usual beautiful prose. Mathematics, rightly viewed, possesses not only truth but supreme beauty, a beauty cold and austere like that of sculpture, without appeal to any part of our weaker nature, without the gorgeous trappings of painting or music, yet sublimely pure and capable of a stern perfection such as only the greatest art can show. Well, yes, I agree, but doing mathematics is completely different. And I want to give a quote by somebody who was an inspiration for both myself and for Jim and for countless others. His name is Giancarlo Rota. He was a professor of mathematics at MIT, also for a couple of years right here at the Rockefeller Institute. And he was a giant of 20th century combinatorics, particularly algebraic combinatorics, which in one way he really developed the field in a tremendous way. But at the same time, mathematics is an intensely personal subject, and he was an inspirational figure, a person, you know, if you listened to him talk, you wanted to work on his problems, and he was incredibly encouraging to young talent, as Jim and I were a couple of years ago. So here is what he says about doing mathematics. A mathematician's work is mostly a tangle of guesswork, analogy, wistful thinking, and frustration. And proof, far from being the core of discovery, is more often than not a way of making sure that our minds are not playing tricks. Jim is an inspirational teacher, an inspirational expositor, and today he'll give us some insight into just how mathematicians work on mathematical problems. So please welcome Jim Propp.
Thank you for those words, Joel, and thank you, Cindy and Tim, for inviting me. I've been looking forward to giving this talk for a very long time. So I'm guessing that nearly all of you walked through the entranceway to get here. How many of you noticed that you were walking through a red hexagon? Okay. Well, when you go back out, there's a cube right at the entranceway. It's got six glass sides, which we mathematicians prefer to call faces. And each of those faces has a diagonal stripe on it, which together form a regular hexagon tilted at a jaunty angle. This is one of the less obvious cross-sections that you can get when slicing a cube in half. You can play with cross-sections of a cube using that wall of fire over there, which is actually closed now because the museum is closed, but there's a portable version here, which is on, which is called the ring of fire. So let me switch the display to that. And let me take this cube. And you can see a square cross section. A little lower? Okay. And if you want to see that hexagonal cross section I mentioned, here it is. Okay. So this girl in the picture has created a four-sided cross section of a cube in the ring of fire. So I'm going to talk about a theorem that's not an especially important theorem, and it wasn't especially hard to prove, but I wanted to tell you about it because it was conceived right here a couple of years ago. Here's the kind of question that leads to the theorem. When you take a triangular pyramid, which mathematicians prefer to call a tetrahedron, and intersect it with a plane, what can you get? So one thing you can get is a triangle. Lower? Okay, get a triangle. A fun challenge is to try to find a square cross-section of this tetrahedron, and I'll come back to that later. But it turns out you can get a triangle, you can get a square. Can you get a pentagon? How many of you think you can get a pentagonal cross-section? It turns out that you can't, because the tetrahedron has just four faces, one on the bottom and then these three tilted ones up here, four faces total. And when you intersect a plane with this shape, that plane can touch, can cross each face at most once. And that intersection is a side of the cross-section polygon. So since the most number of sides, oops, there, I just answered the question. There you can see the tetrahedral, the square cross section. Yeah, let's switch that. Okay. So there we see a configuration in which the wall of fire is crossing each of the four sides of the tetrahedron. And so we get four sides of the intersection polygon. But you can't get more because it would have to cross five faces of this tetrahedron, and it only has four faces. So now let's go up to the cube. When you intersect a cube with a plane, what can you get? Well, it's not hard to get three sides or four sides. Can you get five sides? Yeah, you can get five sides. You can even get six sides. Can the polygon of intersection have more than six sides? I see you shaking your heads, no. And it's because the cube has only six sides, or as I prefer to say, faces. And the plane of fire can only cross as many faces as there are. And here there are only six. So if you cross the plane with all six of the faces at once, you can get a six-sided intersection, but you can't get more than six. So now we know what a cross-section can look like. Now we can ask another question. What is the average number of sides? Okay. But what does average mean when you're averaging over an infinite set, the set of all possible cross-sections? So it turns out that the answer to such questions can depend subtly on what you mean by average. And this phenomenon shows up very dramatically in a famous probability paradox called Bertrand's paradox. So here's a circle and an equilateral triangle inscribed in the circle. Let's call its side length S. So some chords of the circle, like the red one shown at the bottom, are shorter than S, and others, like the green one that's almost a diameter in the middle of the picture, are longer than S. Joseph Bertrand asked, what's the probability that a random chord of the circle is longer than S? So how many of you think the answer is a half? Raise your hand. How many of you think the answer is a third? Raise your hand. How many of you think the answer is a quarter? Raise your hand. Okay? So it turns out Bertrand proved that all of you who raised your hands are right. Okay? He proved that the answer is a half, and he proved that the answer is a third, and he proved that the answer is a quarter, using different notions of the phrase random chord. So the big lesson of that era in the theory of geometric probability is that you have to be very precise about what you mean by random. So those of you who didn't raise your hand, you're right too, because the question doesn't have a single right answer. So I won't go into Bertrand's proofs, but to see why the word random is subtle, imagine picking a random point on Earth's surface by choosing a random latitude and a random longitude. If you do this on a transparent globe and you shift the poles a little bit, this is what you get. If we do it 1,000 times and plot the points on a hollow or glass sphere, you'd see a lot of clustering of the sample points around the poles, and the sample points would be a lot more sparse near the equator. So here you see those clusters at those two points, which aren't at the top and bottom because I wanted the clusters to be clearer, so move them off center. And you can see clusters at both poles because the sphere is transparent. So that doesn't look random. Doesn't look like what we think random should mean. The latitude band between 0 and 10 degrees north comprises much more of Earth's surface area-wise than the latitude band between 50 and 60 degrees north, which in turn is much bigger than the latitude band between 80 and 90 degrees north. And yet our system of choosing a random latitude is going to give equal numbers of points in all three of those latitudinal bands, even though they aren't all occupying the same area. That's what's going on with that clustering. Those bands have the same width, but they have very different lengths, and so they have very different areas. So what's wrong with this scheme for picking a random point by choosing a random latitude between 0 and 90, between negative 90 and positive 90, and choosing a random longitude between 0 and 360, is that the spacing of the points isn't statistically uniform, and we think random should mean uniform. More specifically, the probability that a randomly chosen point on the sphere lies in a particular region, let's call that region R, should be proportional to the area of the region R. It shouldn't depend on where R is, whether it's near the equator or near one of the poles. So now we know what's wrong with this scheme. It's not so easy to come up with a good scheme, how to accomplish a way of choosing points that's going to be statistically uniform. But let's do it in a different setting where it's easy to do, namely a line segment. We want to choose a point on a line segment so that each piece of the line segment will have the same statistical properties as any other. And we can do this with the probabilist's favorite tool, a fair coin. So let's consider a line segment of length 1. We want to choose a random point on it. I'm going to toss a coin 100 times. If I wanted to get more accuracy, maybe I'd do it 1,000 times, but 100 will be good enough for our purposes. Toss a coin 100 times to generate 100 bits, where we use 0 for heads and 1 for tails. Then I can use those zeros and ones to write down a real number between 0 and 1 in binary, just writing the digits, those bits, in order. So for example, if I toss heads followed by tails, I'm going to write down 0.01, and then maybe more bits after it according to the coin tosses that I get. Now if you've pre-selected some interval, the probability that my number that I choose with these coin tosses will land in your interval is going to be proportional to the length of the interval you've chosen. In fact, it will be equal to the length of the interval. So let me not prove that for all intervals. Let me just do it for one interval that illustrates the idea. I'll use the interval from a quarter to a half. That interval consists of the numbers which, if you write them in binary, begin 0.01, dot, dot, dot. So my random number will land in your pre-selected interval if the first bit of my number is a 0 and the second bit of my number is a 1. But that corresponds to my first tossing heads on my first coin toss and then tossing tails on the second. Since this is a fair coin, the probability of tossing heads is a half, the probability of tails is a half, and since a fair coin has no memory, those events are statistically independent of each other, so the probability of tossing heads first and then tails is going to be a half times a half, which is a quarter. And a quarter is exactly the length of the interval that you pre-selected, from a quarter to one half. So that's one example of how this way of choosing a point at random has the desired properties of representing each subinterval proportionately according to its length. So we can use coin tosses to find a random point on the number line between 0 and 1, or more generally a random point in any finite length interval. And computers do this sort of thing all the time, except instead of tossing coins, they use pseudo-random number generators. So now let's go back to that question. What is the average number of sides of a random slice? If we want to be respectable probabilists, we'd say, if you choose a slice at random, what is the expected value of the number of sides? I won't give a technical definition of expected value, which is also called mathematical expectation, but it more or less corresponds to the intuitive idea of average value. I also want to clarify a few implicit assumptions. First of all, I want the wall of fire to be infinite, not finite like this disk over here. I'm going to call it the plane of fire, just to highlight that. Also, I'm not interested in cases where no part of the cube is in the plane of fire, so the cross-section is the empty set. So I'm not interested in the cube being all the way out here or in some other part of the museum or out on the street. I only care about looking at the cross-section when it actually intersects the plane of fire. If just one point of the cube lies in the plane of fire, that's fine. But if no points of the cube are in the plane of fire, we rule that out. We're not interested in those positions. So at this point in the talk, it's still unclear how to randomize the orientation of the cube, how to wobble it around all the different possible axes. So I'm not going to want to get into that. So instead, I'm going to hold the orientation of this cube fixed while altering its position in space. So I'm allowed to translate it, but not to rotate it. For instance, let's look at all the cross sections formed when the body diagonal of the cube that joins one corner of the cube to the opposite corner is perpendicular to the wall of fire. So let's switch back. So I'm going to hold it like this, and the cross section is a point, and it's a point, it's a triangle, it's a hexagon, it's a triangle, point, and now it's gone. So some of the intersections were triangles and some were hexagons. Are these two possibilities equally likely? Or do we see a different mixture of sometimes triangle, sometimes hexagon? So in the spirit of geometric probability, we replace this by a geometric question. As we slide the cube through the wall at constant speed, what fraction of the time is the cross-section a triangle? And what fraction of the time is the cross-section a hexagon? It's going to be helpful to look at things from the cube's point of view. So to imagine that the cube is still and the plane is what's doing the moving, but moving at constant speed. I'm going to put the cube in standard position so that its corners, its eight corners, are triples of coordinates, each of which is a 0 or a 1. So the point 0, 0, 0 is down there at the lower left. The point 1, 1, 1 is at the upper right. And all the other points have coordinates x equals 0 or 1, y equals 0 or 1, and z equals 0 or 1. And the coming plane that I'm going to use is going to be perpendicular to the line segment joining 0, 0, 0 to 1, 1, 1. And those are planes of the form x plus y plus z equals some constant. And that constant is going to change. We're going to imagine that constant changing at constant speed. So we're going to start with the plane x plus y plus z equals 0, which intersects the cube at just one point, the corner point 0, 0, 0. Now I'm going to move that cutting plane a fixed distance. So now I'm looking at x plus y plus z equals 0.25. So now the cross section is going to be triangular. Move the plane again by an equal amount. So we get x plus y plus z equals 0.50. It's a larger triangle as the cross section. Larger triangle is the cross-section. When we get to x plus y plus z equals 1, it's a big triangle. But now something different happens. If the plane continues to move, the three sides of the triangle broaden out to become sides of their own, while the sides of the triangle we had before start to get shorter. So we get a hexagon with three short sides and three long sides. If we now progress to x plus y plus z equals 1.50, the lengthening short sides become the same length as the shortening long sides of the hexagon. So we get a regular hexagon, the same regular hexagon you walked through when you came in the entrance. Now we have x plus y plus z equals 1.75. The shorter sides that used to be the long sides are getting even shorter, and vice versa for the other sides, until finally when we get to x plus y plus z equals 2, we're back at a triangle. But the plane's journey isn't over yet. We keep going to x plus y plus z equals 2.25. We get a triangle, smaller triangle. By the way, all these cross sections are equally spaced from each other. So as you increase the right-hand side of the equation, x plus y plus z equals something, as you change the right-hand side at constant rate, the plane is moving at a constant speed through space. And finally, we get to x plus y plus z equals 3. That's going to intersect the cube just at the point 1, 1, 1. So for the first third of the plane's journey, we see a triangle. For the next third, we see a hexagon. And for the last third, we see a triangle. So two-thirds of the time, the cross-section has three sides. And one-third of the time, the cross-section has six sides. So the average number of sides is two-thirds times 3 plus one-third times 6, which is 4. Or here's another way to compute it, which might be helpful to you during the exercise I'm going to give you during the intermission. You say it's 3 for a while. That's the number of sides. Then the number of sides is 6 for an equal amount of time. And then it's 3 again for an equal amount of time. So the average over time is 3 plus 6 plus 3 divided by the number of bands into which we've divided our time interval, namely 3. So we get 3 plus 6 plus 3 over 3, which is 4. If you didn't know the answer was 4, you might still be able to guess it by doing computer experiments. So what do I mean by that? You'd have the computer look at the intersection between the unit cube and the plane x plus y plus z equals t, where t is chosen randomly between 0 and 3. So I told you before I had a sample from a segment or from an interval in the real line. So you can use that method to choose a random number between 0 and 3, choose the cutting plane x plus y plus z equals that number t, have the computer compute the intersection as a polygon, figure out how many sides the polygon has, and then keep track of what number you found as you do this experiment over and over and over again. The law of large numbers says that if the computer does this enough times and outputs the average number of sides in the polygons it's generated so far, the average will converge to the true average, 4. So if you do it a million times and you see 4.007 or something, you'll think, that's suspiciously close to 4. Maybe the true answer is 4. So now I'm going to replace the cube by a parallelepiped, which includes the cube as a special case. So let me remind you what a parallelepiped is. It's like a cube, except instead of having three perpendicular axes, which are the same length in the case of a cube, they could be in different directions, and they can be of different lengths. So if you imagine three different directions you can go, you can take any two of them and form a parallelogram. If you take two copies of that parallelogram, those will be two of the faces of the parallelepiped. And if you form all the different combinations of choosing two of those three different directions, you're going to get not two, but three pairs of opposite faces that are parallelograms. So here's a parallelogram over here, and there's a matching parallelogram over here, and those will be the six faces of your parallelepiped. So now I'd like you to imagine passing a parallelepiped through the plane of fire and looking at the cross sections. Since the parallelepiped has only six faces, the same argument we saw before tells you that the cross section can't have more than six sides. So you're always going to get a cross section with 3, 4, 5, or 6 sides. And the question I'll ask is, how many sides does it have on average? Now, you're about to get a chance to explore this in a hands-on way, but I can't give each of you your own parallelepiped and your own private wall of fire, so we're going to bring the problem down a dimension with parallelepipeds that can actually be drawn not just approximately, but exactly on a piece of paper. So I'm going to replace the parallelepiped by a stick figure on a piece of paper consisting of 12 line segments. I'll call it a squashed parallelepiped. So this may look three-dimensional, but it's not meant to. It's just a bunch of line segments in a plane. So this is a two-dimensional representation of a three-dimensional object, where I've drawn some of the lines as dashed to imply that they're behind the other lines. This is not a three-dimensional object in any sense. It's just a bunch of line segments. And instead of having a plane of fire, we're going to have a line of fire. Here's a line of fire. It's just a line sitting inside that plane. So here's a line of fire, and it intersects the squashed parallelepiped in 5 points. Okay? Instead of imagining that the line of fire stays put and the squashed parallelepiped moves through it, let's imagine that the squashed parallelepiped stays put while the line of fire moves past it. So here's what that looks like. Okay? So we're going to assume that the speed is uniform, and we'll look at the number of points in the intersection between the squashed parallelepiped and the line of fire. This is going to be a function of time, from the moment of first contact to the moment of last contact, and we want to compute its average value. But since the line of fire is moving at constant speed, the average as a function of time can also be written as an average over position, which is what you're going to be doing on your sheets. So you're going to be in teams of two, and each team will have a clipboard and four markers. So half of you have clipboards with graph paper, and half of you have four markers. And you're going to do some mathematical experiments. For each experiment, use the colored markers to design a squashed parallelepiped consisting of four parallel and equal red segments, four parallel and equal blue segments, and four parallel and equal green segments, sort of like this, but different. So edges that are the same color should be parallel and equal, but edges that aren't the same color should not be parallel. They can be equal in length if you want, but they should not be parallel. And we're going to want all the points to lie on vertical grid lines, just to make it possible for you to do certain kinds of calculations. But other than that, you can be creative. Those points, by the way, do not have to lie on the horizontal grid lines in your graph paper, just on the vertical grid lines. Here's what you're going to do after you've drawn your squashed parallelepiped. For any vertical band lying between two consecutive vertical grid lines, count how many different line segments from the squashed parallelepiped cross that band, since that tells you the number of intersections between the squashed parallelepiped and the line of fire when the line of fire lies in that band. Let me show you what that means. Say the line of fire lies in the leftmost band between that leftmost grid line and the grid line to its right. Notice how that line intersects the squashed parallelepiped in 3 points? That's going to be true for all the positions of that line of fire within that band. So with your black number, you're going to write down the number 3. Let's move on to the next band. If the line of fire lies anywhere in that band, line of fire is always vertical, parallel to those grid lines, the line of fire will cross 3 of those segments that are the edges of the squashed parallelepiped. One red, one blue, and one green. Since it's going to cross 3 of them, I've written the number 3 down below. And likewise here, if the line of fire falls in that band, it's going to cross 4 edges of the squashed parallelepiped, so I write down the number 4. And for the next band, 5. And for the next band, 6. And then it goes 5, 4, 3, 3 again. So remember, we only want to look at positions where the line of fire crosses the squashed parallelepiped in at least one point. I don't want to look at positions of the cube, where the cube is upstairs or out of the museum. Likewise, I want the line of fire to actually cross the squashed parallelepiped. So all the numbers you write down should be positive. If you write down a 0, that means you're looking at a band in which the line of fire doesn't cross the squashed parallelepiped at all, and we've agreed not to count these positions. Now once you've computed a black number for each of these bands, I want you to compute the average of the black numbers to find the average number of intersections between the stationary squashed parallelepiped and the moving line of fire. Why do I want you to do that? Well, there are 9 equal width bands, and the line of fire is going to spend 1/9 of the time in each of those bands. So if in 1/9 of the time the line of fire lies in this band and it meets the squashed parallelepiped in 3 points, and 1/9 of the time it intersects it in 3 points because it's in the second band, and 1/9 of the time it's 4 points, 1/9 of the time it's 5 points, etc. for each of the bands, then to find the average number of points of intersection, we should average those numbers. So we'd average the numbers 3, 3, 4, 5, 6, 5, 4, 3, and 3, and that will give you the average number of intersections between a line of fire moving at uniform speed and the squashed parallelepiped that you've drawn. Now your picture could look different from mine. For instance, here's a different one. And you'll notice that I haven't written a zero underneath the left band or underneath the right band, because remember, we're not interested in positions of a line of fire that don't cross the squashed parallelepiped. But it does cross the other bands, and so I've written 3, 3, 6, 6, 3, 3 in those other bands. So are people clear on what I'm asking you to do? Any questions? Okay. I'm going to give you about 10 minutes to work on this in pairs. Feel free to ask me questions or to tell me what you found as I wander around the room. So here's a suggestion for how you might draw one of these things, which is choose a point, draw a red edge, draw a blue edge, and draw a green edge, and then fill in. So for instance, if you want to know how long this should be, it has to be the same length as this. And if you draw a red edge from here, it has to be forming a parallelogram with this thing over here. So that's kind of one order in which you can draw it so that it'll all be consistent. Yeah. Try drawing it with all the corners points are actually at grid lines, intersections, so that you'd have like a point over here instead of over here, and maybe over here instead of over here. Because then you can say, oh, that line is always going to be 1/3 up, and then just make sure you follow that consistently all the time. That should help.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay, so I'm sorry to cut some of you off. We're still working on this exercise. Okay. So many of you noticed that there could be some exceptional moments corresponding to some exceptional positions of the line of fire when the number of points of intersection suddenly dips down. Like here, the line of fire crosses the squashed parallelepiped in 6 points. But if we move the line of fire just far enough to the right, so it's exactly halfway from the left to the right, there are only 4 points of intersection, because the green is crossing the blue up above, I'm sorry, the red is crossing the green up above, and the red is also crossing the green down below. But there are only finitely many of those exceptional moments, and there are infinitely many moments when the cross sections aren't exceptional, so we can ignore the exceptional moments. In geometric probability terms, a single point has length 0, and any finite collection of points has total length 0, so such a collection can be ignored. Now, this glosses over a fascinating topic, namely non-empty sets of measure 0, and what it means for an event to be possible but still have probability 0, but that would take us too far out of our way. Also, some of you noticed that if one of the edges of the squashed parallelepiped is parallel to the line of fire, move that line that you see in this picture a little bit to the right, at the instant that the line of fire coincides with the vertical edge of the squashed parallelepiped, the number of points of intersection is infinite, because all the points on that edge lie in the intersection. And this is more problematic, but again, a rigorous discussion using geometric probability theory would give us a rationale for ignoring those exceptional moments because there are only finitely many of them. But the really important thing that happened during the intermission is that even though all of you had different black numbers, when you took the average of your black numbers, you got the same answer, namely 4. And some of you got this answer more than once from multiple experiments. So you found strong experimental evidence for a conjecture. If you pass a squashed parallelepiped through a line at constant speed, or vice versa, then the average number of points of intersection from the moment of first contact to the moment of last contact is 4. So let's prove it. So here's the picture I showed you before. It's going to be completely typical, but we want to focus on a specific example, so I'll use this one. Notice that what I've done below is I've taken the 12 colored edges of the squashed parallelepiped and sort of ignored the fact that they're diagonal and just laid them out horizontally. So for example, over here, I have a red edge that passes through two bands. I've replaced that by a red segment of length 1 and another red segment of length 1 passing through those two bands. So I'm choosing to measure distance so that each band has width 1. And likewise, this blue edge, which passes through three bands, is represented by these three segments. And this red edge that passes through two bands is represented by these two over here. So now let's think about what the numbers we've written down here represent. This 3 represents the number of intervals of width 1 that appear below it. This 6 represents the number of intervals of width 1 that appear below that, and so on for the other numbers. So when we're adding up the numbers 3, 3, 4, 5, 6, 5, 4, 3, 3, what we're doing is we're counting the number of intervals that appear in the bottom half of this picture. And the way we're going to count them is by changing the way we look at them. And the way I want you to look at them is the way I've sort of drawn them as being separated from each other. So we have two red intervals of length 2. We have, four red intervals of length 2, four blue intervals of length 3, and four green intervals of length 4. And we want to add the lengths of those intervals. So what we want to compute is 4 times the length of each red interval, plus 4 times the length of each blue interval, plus 4 times the length of each green interval. But if you look at the top of the squash parallelepiped, you'll see a red segment followed by a blue segment followed by a green segment that stretches with no overlaps or gaps from the left end point of the squashed parallelepiped to the right end point. Correspondingly, we can find a red segment of length 2, followed by a blue segment of length 3, followed by a green segment of length 4, which collectively span the whole picture from left to right with no gaps or overlaps. That means that the sum of the red length and the blue length and the green length has got to be the number of bands, because each band is crossed by exactly one of these three segments: this red segment, this blue segment, and this green segment. So the sum of the lengths of a red segment and a blue segment and a green segment must be the number of bands. But we have not just one, but 4 red segments, and likewise 4 blue segments and 4 green segments. So when we add the lengths of all the segments, which I'll remind you is going to be equal to the sum of these numbers, we're going to get 4 times the number of bands. Now remember, we're not just interested in adding these numbers, we're interested in averaging them. So if the sum of those numbers, as we've just shown, is 4 times the number of bands, and we divide that by the number of bands, that leaves us with 4. So we've just shown that for this specific example, the average of those black numbers must be 4. Not by calculating it with arithmetic, but by thinking about it conceptually. And this conceptual approach is going to apply to any squashed parallelepiped we draw for the same reason. There's always a way to move from the leftmost point to the rightmost point following a single red edge and a single green edge and a single blue edge, not necessarily in that order. So that means the sum of red plus blue plus green must equal the width, and so on, as we did before. So that's the proof for 2 dimensions. The same idea applied in 3 dimensions proves the wall of fire theorem, which was conjectured and proved in October of 2017. It says if you pass a parallelepiped through a plane at constant speed, then the average number of sides in the polygon of intersection from the moment of first contact to the moment of last contact is exactly 4. The difference is that when we move from 2 dimensions, like what you were doing on your papers, to 3 dimensions, like I could be doing in the Ring of Fire, instead of counting intersections between a squashed parallelepiped and a line of fire living in the plane, we're counting intersections between a true parallelepiped and a plane of fire living in a 3-dimensional space. But the method of proof is the same. So now that I've described the result and shown you a proof of it, I want to tell you the history of this discovery, including the story of the 3 proofs that I know. So here's the chronology going back to 2017. October 7th was the kickoff of the Global Math Project. And while I was here, I was playing with a wall of fire and began musing about the average number of sides. And a day later, I posted the question on the Math Fun email forum. Sidebar on that, Math Fun is an ancient mathematical email forum. By ancient, I mean more than 20 years old. For serious amateurs and playful professionals. Here are some recent topics that have been threads on this email forum. That last one, GOL, means game of life. That's Conway's game of life. So if these topics appeal to you, then please get in touch with me and I'll put you in touch with the moderator of the Math Fun forum. Anyway, getting back to our story, there was a flurry of email on October 8th and 9th as Alan Wexler, Dan Asimov, Victor Miller, and others, and I tried to figure out how to clarify the question, and we hit on a scheme for varying the orientation and position of the cube. That's a fairly natural one. So then a week passed. And then Keith Lynch, who had implemented our definition of random cutting plane on a computer and done some computer experiments, reported the results of an experiment showing that the average appeared to be about 4.0004. And he asked, could the average be exactly 4? That same day, Warren Smith said the answer was exactly 4 and gave a proof, the first proof of the theorem. 3 days later, George Hart, who along with Glenn Whitney was one of the founders of the museum and one of the creators of the Wall of Fire, gave a different proof. In trying to understand Hart's proof, I came up with a similar proof of my own a day later, and that is the proof that I showed you. I've tried to present it in as accessible a form as possible, so that's not quite the language that I used in stating the proof, but that's the essential idea. George Hart's proof, the second proof that was found, was a lot like the proof I've shown you, except instead of asking how many corners the cross-section has on average, he asked how many sides it has on average. Now, of course, that's going to give the same answer because the cross-section is a polygon, and a polygon always has as many corners as it has sides. But if you think about where the corners and sides come from, they come from different places. A corner of the cross-section comes from where the cutting plane intersects an edge of the cube, whereas a side of the cross-section comes from a place where the cutting plane cuts a face of the cube. Now, of course, you're going to get the same answer since each cross-section has as many sides as corners, but the method of calculation will be different. So that was George Hart's proof. Warren Smith's proof is completely different. He invites us to picture not just a single cube passing through a plane, but a whole infinite 3D grid of cubes passing through a plane. So think about not just a single cube, but a cube sitting next to it, and a cube sitting next to it, and a cube sitting above it, and a cube sitting in front of it. A regular latticework of cubes filling all of 3-dimensional space, and now imagine sliding that through the plane of fire. That's hard to picture. But let me give you an example with an animation. Let's look at the case where the body diagonals of all those cubes, joining diametrically opposite points on a single cube, are perpendicular to the plane of fire. In that case, the intersection of the whole grid of cubes with the plane of fire gives a picture that looks like what's called a trihexagonal tiling, or a Kagome lattice. So here's a video made by the educational animator Lucas Vieira, and I'll show you what you get as the plane of fire moves through that. It's only a finite collection of cubes, 4 by 4 by 4, but it should give you the idea of what happens for an infinite grid of cubes. So we've two-colored the cubes so you can see the pattern more clearly. So the cross sections are also going to be two-colored, light blue and dark blue. So you always see triangles and hexagons. Well, that's not quite true. There will be exceptional moments. Let's see if I can catch it just right. Yeah, when you, well, didn't quite right. Those, let's see if I can catch it now. No, still didn't quite catch it. There are exceptional moments when those triangles disappear and the hexagons disappear and you just see triangles. But most of the time you see triangles, hexagons, and squares. And you have one hexagon for every two triangles, so the average number of sides is the average of 3, 3, and 6, which is 4. The cool fact that makes Smith's proof work is that when you have infinitely many straight lines dividing a plane into bounded polygonal pieces, the average number of pieces, sorry, the average number of sides of the pieces is always 4 as long as there are no triple intersection points. What we were looking at before the intermission, when we were moving just one cube through the plane of fire, is essentially the same thing as following one of the regions in this movie and taking the time average of the number of sides it has from birth to death. So a piece is born, it lives, it shrinks, it's dead. And you take the time average of the number of sides. That corresponds to a single cube passing into and then out of the wall. What Smith is doing is replacing the time average by a space average where we freeze time, but view the current region as just part of a big tiling of the plane. Showing that the time average and space average are equal takes work, but I hope you can see how it might be true. Instead of going into the niceties, I'll show you a picture illustrating a related result pointed out to me by Olivier Bernardi. If you have a bunch of lines in the plane, no three of which meet at a point, if you take any quadrilateral formed by four of those lines and look at the pieces that all the other lines chop that in up into, then the average number of sides of the pieces is 4. So here's 8 lines in the plane. I've chosen 4 of them to form a square. The other 4 lines chop that square up into 5 pieces. But if you look at the pieces and take the average number of sides, you get the average of 3, 3, 3, 3, and 8, which is, again, 4. Now, so far, we've talked about cubes and parallelepipeds. What about other shapes? I don't know the average number of sides of a cross-section of a tetrahedron, but I do know that unlike the situation with a cube, where the orientation doesn't matter and you get the answer 4 regardless, if you hold the tetrahedron in a fixed orientation, the average depends on the orientation that you picked. That's because if you hold the tetrahedron corner facing you and pass it through the wall of fire, it has 3 sides from beginning to end. Whereas if you hold the tetrahedron with its edge starting going through, then it's going to be a rectangle with 4 sides all the way through. So the average can be 3 for some orientations, it can be 4 for others, and it can have intermediate values for other orientations. So if there is a nice answer for the average number of sides of the cross-section, the proof is not going to be as nice because it genuinely depends on averaging over different orientations. What about other things like the regular dodecahedron? Okay? This is going to be like the tetrahedron. The number of sides that an average cross-section has, if you average over just the cross-sections for planes in a particular orientation, is going to depend on what orientation you pick. So it's not going to be a simple story. On the other hand, if you choose a less well-known picture, the rhombic dodecahedron, things work out very nicely. If you pass a rhombic dodecahedron through the wall of fire, the average number of sides of the cross-section is 6, regardless of the orientation. Rhombic dodecahedra, like parallelepipeds, are examples of polyhedra called zonahedra. This is an image created by George Hart showing some other examples of zonahedra. There's a different way you could try to follow up on the wall of fire theorem. Go back to the cube and get more refined information about the probability that a random intersection has 3, 4, 5, or 6 sides. This is an unsolved problem. Empirically, Keith Lynch got the numbers shown below, or rather over there, but what are the exact values? I don't know. We can also ask other kinds of questions about a random cross-section of a cube. For instance, what is the expected area? If you fix the orientation of the cube, then the average area of the cross-sections equals the volume of the cube divided by the width of the cube in its direction of motion, where the width is defined as the distance between two parallel tangent planes. So in the case of a cube, if we look at these two parallel planes, tangent to the cube at two opposite faces, well then the cross-sectional area is always going to be the area of one of the faces, and that area is indeed equal to the volume of the cube divided by the width in that direction, because volume divided by side length equals area of a face. But this assertion is also true if we held the cube in this direction and the two tangent planes were like this. So the average area for cross sections in a particular orientation of the cutting plane will always equal the volume divided by the distance between the two tangent planes. That's called the width of the cube in that direction. But what if you don't fix the orientation of the cube? What if you average over all orientations? Then it turns out that the average area of the cross sections equals the volume of the cube divided by something called the mean width of the cube, which is the average of its width in all the different possible directions. It turns out that the mean width of a cube of side length s is 3/2 times s. So that implies that the average cross-sectional area of a cube, if you allow cutting planes in all orientations, is going to be 2/3 times s squared. So that's a nice answer. I'd like to know what the expected perimeter of a random cross-section is, but I don't know what it is. So if you figure that out, please let me know. Now, about a year ago, I was telling a friend, a non-mathematician, about the wall of fire problem and the question of what is the expected number of sides of a random cross-section of a cube, and he stopped me, and very politely he said, "I don't mean to be rude, but can you tell me why the question is interesting?" And his request stumped me in the moment, and it was only later that I realized that in and of itself, the question isn't interesting. Because we mathematicians ask questions all the time, and often we don't know whether they're interesting, because the criterion that a pure mathematician uses in judging whether a question is interesting is whether the answer is interesting. For instance, it's interesting and surprising that the average number of sides is such a nice number, namely 4. But it's even more interesting that you can hold the orientation of the cube fixed, and the answer is always that same number, 4. And when a pure mathematician encounters something surprising like that, that wasn't inherent in the question, but seems to be part of the answer, the mathematician scratches her or his head and says, "Huh, I wonder what's going on here." So when something is true about cubes, but false about tetrahedra, and it's false for regular dodecahedra, but true for rhombic dodecahedra, we start to think, wait a second, there's something going on here, and it's my job to figure out what it is. So I would say that unlike applied mathematics, where one of the drivers of what you do with your time as a mathematician is solving some real-world problem, one of the main drivers of pure math is traveling in the direction of greatest surprise. You've got three things that you know, and two of them are kind of routine, but one of them isn't what you would have expected. That's the thing you choose to delve more deeply into. Aside from the fact that the wall of fire theorem was conceived here, I'm happy to be talking about it because it highlights a bunch of points about mathematics, one of which is the collaborative nature of mathematics. I wouldn't be here today telling you about these results if there hadn't been people on the Math Fund forum helping me clarify the question, Keith Lynch doing the computer experiment, Warren Smith and George Hart figuring out proofs. So it's a very collaborative enterprise. This theorem also highlights the role of experimentation, and in particular, computer experimentation in guiding us to good conjectures which can intrigue us to the point of making us do the hard work of trying to figure out why they're true. It also shows that mathematicians aren't satisfied with just a single proof of a result. Just as we learn more about a cube by examining it from different angles, face on, edge on, corner on, we learn more things about mathematical reality by looking for as many ways to prove things as we can. Lastly, the story of the theorem demonstrates that you can find new problems in math not just by reading the latest research articles in journals, but also just by keeping your eyes open to mathematical patterns in the world around you. Maybe your next theorem is here in this museum, waiting for you to find it. Thank you.
So if anybody has any questions, you can raise your hand. I'll bring the microphone to you.
Is there any general relationship to the number of edges?
Between the number of edges and the expected number of sides in the cross-section?
Yes.
There is a relationship, but it involves other things as well. So you have to know more information about the zonahedron, if that's the context in which you're asking this. So there's other analogs of the wall of fire theorem for other shapes, and the number of edges definitely plays a role.
So is there anything you can say about a polyhedron and its dual with regard to these properties?
That's an interesting question. So a polyhedron and its dual. Well, I can say that the dual of the cube is the octahedron, and the octahedron is not a zonahedron. So the method of proof that I've shown here doesn't apply. But that doesn't mean that there isn't an interesting answer to the question of how many sides you have on average for an octahedron. So I'd be very interested if anyone can explore that experimentally or with rigorous methods to see what the average number of sides of an octahedron is when you intersect it with a random plane. That might be very interesting. I don't know.
Hi. I'm not a mathematician, but can you tell me what that ring is, that wall of fire? What is it?
Oh, I believe it is a ring of lasers. I'm not sure how many, but...
There are 12 lasers.
12 lasers. And they're set up in such a way that I can move my hand anywhere in there. Let's do it with a cylinder. And you see a circle. So somehow they've cleverly set this up so that the laser beams, even though there's only 12 of them, they manage to illuminate all the points inside this disk more or less evenly.
Each of those lasers has a little lens that spreads the light out from being a single line into a little fan of light. So adding them all up, it creates a plane of light.
Yeah. No, it's quite beautifully done. Look how close the cylinder is to the border of the ring. Oh, yeah, let me move it.
You can certainly come up and have a close look.
But I'll do it so that anyone who wants to can see it on the screen at the side. Okay. So
a little higher?
Okay. So I can move it around a lot, and you don't see any change in that ring. It's just a solid ring, which is the physical representation of the mathematical intersection of the surface of the cylinder with the plane that goes through this ring of fire. And I can bring it pretty close to the boundary before that ring starts to break. Well, I don't know of a way to show that without going out of focus, but anyway.
Do you think the result's true if you have an irregular, whatever you call it, cube or anyway, this kind of cuboid type thing, but the edges are all different lengths? Because, you know, your picture would still be the same. You'd still have these paths that all add up to the length of the length from one point to the opposite diagonal point. So maybe even if they're irregular, but if it's a cuboid shape, it still has average four.
That's a great question, and I haven't thought that through, but you can be sure I will later tonight.
This is weird, but in the intermission, I got a shape that all the numbers are four, like literally.
Uh-huh. 4, 4, 4. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Great.
It's kind of interesting how that can happen.
Yeah. It can happen.
And it's kind of weird why it's like that. Like, why is it with the red?
Yeah, can I show them?
Right on the line.
Let me see if I can put it. Well, first I'll hold it up to see, and then I'll try putting it in the document camera. So you've chosen a parallelepiped or squash parallelepiped, which has some vertical edges to it. And so I think that's related to the fact that you got four going all the way through from left to right. Yeah.
Up there. 3, 4, 5, 5, 6.
Yep. Yeah, there's something special about having vertical edges as opposed to horizontal edges because of the way we're measuring things from left to right in these pictures down here. Very good.
Let's give another hand for our speaker.
Thank you.